So we have about 12 minutes with Mr. Hajdu. If there's any question on the phone, operator?
Yes, we do have a question from David Aiken Global News. Please go ahead.
Hi, David.
Hey, good afternoon, Minister. Thanks for taking our questions. Appreciate it.
My pleasure.
Sorry, I'm on speakerphone from the home office here, so you can hear me. I just wanted to talk about rapid home testing kits. I was in touch with some of your officials earlier today who note that Health Canada has not approved any home testing kits yet, and right now there's no home testing kits that are being evaluated. And yet the U.S. FDA has just this week approved another home testing kit that offers a result, you know, at home in 30 minutes. Just wondering, you know, what does Health Canada know that the FDA does not know? What does the FDA know that Health Canada doesn't know? Curious about home testing kits.
Well, thanks, David, for the question. And the one that was approved by the U.S. FDA, I believe yesterday, that particular device has not the manufacturers have not applied to Canada yet. I've asked the department to reach out to the manufacturers and determine whether they'd be interested in marketing to Canada. And then, of course, it would undergo its regulatory review with the regulators. But listen, at the end of the day, we have regulators working around the clock, assessing a variety of different kinds of medical devices that manufacturers have submitted for review. And as soon as they're proven to be safe and effective, then they would be approved. And of course, we've moved forward with a number of other kinds of rapid tests and in fact, have distributed almost 5 million other kinds of rapid tests to provinces and territories over the last month or so.
Okay, that's great. That's interesting to hear. I too have reached out to the manufacturer, but haven't heard from them yet. So,
well, if you get there first, David, then just encourage them to apply to Canada so we can take a look at their data.
Okay, will do. The other question, I guess, generally speaking, is just, you know, you're speaking to epidemiologists these days. Of course, I am as well. And there is the feeling in the community that if we did have some broad distribution of home testing kits, a rapid home testing kit widely available to, you know, everyday sort of Canadians, that could go a long way to stopping the pandemic in its track. And I wonder, you know, what you're hearing from your officials about the potential from a home testing kit distribution.
Well, again, you know, listen, I think the whole world is looking for tools, as you know, from your conversations that can help us with on the screening side and on the testing side. The department is fully seized of applications to for a variety of different devices. And as soon as there's a rapid test that has a certain degree of sensitivity and accuracy, then, of course, we'll, you know, the regulators will approve that test. But at the end of the day, you know, you can't rush science. And I would just say that if there are promising manufacturers out there that have not submitted to Canada, they certainly should, and we will take a look at them very quickly.
We'll take a question.
That's great. Thank you very much.
Perfect. We'll take a question from the room. David.
Hey, Minister Hajdu. Is your government going to support the NDP's private members, pharmacare, the NDP's private members bill to bring in national universal single-payer pharmacare?
Well, thanks for the question. As you know, our government has done more than any government in a generation to lower the cost of pharmaceuticals here in Canada. And certainly a goal of ours is to ensure that we have a national pharmacare plan so that every Canadian can access drugs no matter what their circumstances. And I will just say that I'm looking forward to the debate. You know, one aspect of their particular bill compels provinces and territories. I personally feel, especially through the experience of being the Minister of Health during a pandemic, that we need to work with provinces and territories. And so I'll be listening very closely to the debate to understand what their vision is of working with provinces and territories and having that fully respectful relationship that is pharmacare needs to be built on.
So you haven't made up your mind?
I have not made up my mind.
Thank you so much.
And I'll check once again if we have a question on the phone. Operator?
Thank you. The next question is from Cormac McSweeney from City News. Please go ahead.
Hi, Minister. In the Ontario legislature, Christine Elliott, the health minister there, said that Canada is going to be receiving about 4 million doses of the Pfizer vaccine between January and March and 2 million doses of Moderna's vaccine. And of this, Ontario is going to get 1.6 million of the Pfizer and 800,000 of the Moderna. I don't believe we've had those numbers yet from the federal government. Can you confirm those numbers, and can you expand on this? Can you say what other provinces are expected to get after these vaccine candidates are approved by Health Canada?
Well, thank you for the question. It's really exciting that Canada is well positioned with both of those companies to receive millions of doses of both of those vaccines. Of course, there are a number of steps to go through before we actually get to the point of distribution, including the regulatory review with Health Canada to ensure the safety of both vaccines. The manufacturers, Pfizer and Moderna, have actually submitted to Health Canada for the rolling regulatory approval, which is great. It means they can supply data as they get it, and we can review it very rapidly. And then in terms of distribution, we will work out with provinces and territories as we have with other things like personal protective equipment, rapid tests, a ratio or sharing approach that will work to ensure that all Canadians have access to viable and safe vaccines.
But as a follow-up, can you confirm the numbers that the Ford government has released today that Canada is expecting to receive 4 million doses of the Pfizer vaccine and 2 million of Moderna's between January and March?
As I said, the way that we have negotiated with provinces and territories when we're procuring on behalf of all of Canadians is to ensure that we do this in collaboration and through negotiations with all provinces and territories at the table. Those negotiations continue. They've been very smooth to date. As you know, we have agreements for the distribution of personal protective equipment, for the rapid tests, and we will use the same approach with vaccines.
We'll now take a question from the room. Chris?
Hi, Minister Hajdu. I'm wondering if you think it was a mistake for the Global Public Health Information System Network, to end its international surveillance and warning system?
Well, listen, when I heard reports, as I heard, as many Canadians heard, of scientists within the Public Health Agency of Canada working on that team saying that their findings or their voices were not being heard by senior levels of management, I was deeply concerned. And so that's why I called for the external review. As you know, we've appointed three expert panelists to to lead that review. And I think that they will do an exemplary job at discovering why those decisions were made, and I think even more importantly, how we rebuild the status of the Global Public Health Information Network moving forward and ensure that Canada has a world-class public health information network to lead our way with the variety of different kinds of health threats we face.
So you would like to see the network restored?
I think having public health information that is global is a critically important tool for Canada. And I think that we need to obviously sustain that work. As you know, the public health information network is running now, is providing alerts to officials and to the government. But I think it's very, very important that we understand what happened and furthermore, how we ensure that we build it up to make sure that it has the strongest potential to alert Canada to emerging health threats, both globally, but also here domestically.
And we have time for one more question on the phone, if there is one. Operator?
There are no further questions, Magister, at this time. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Can I get your reaction to the Premier, the BC Premier's suggestion that we restrict travel to essential travel in Canada? Do you think that's a good idea? He's calling on the Prime Minister to restrict travel to essential travel.
We were always looking at ways that we can assist the premiers in discharging their responsibilities to keep people safe, provide health care, and so on. And yes, British Columbia's numbers are quite high right now. But we have a lot of different variability in the different regions across the country. And of course, the Prime Minister has to be thinking of all of Canada, all of Canadians. And so, we're always interested in what the premiers have to say and trying to help them in any way in discharging their responsibilities for keeping people safe and dealing with the healthcare needs and economic needs they have.
Thank you very much. Yeah.
Je crois sincèrement que la langue française est toujours sous menace au Québec. Évidemment, c'est un îlot français en Amérique du Nord. Et il faut faire ce qu'on peut pour aider, pour travailler avec le gouvernement de Québec, tous les deux dans leur domaine de compétences. justement pour protéger, promouvoir le fait français au Québec et pour nous aussi à travers le Canada. Merci. Ça, c'est Madame Jolie, je réponds à la question, mais je sais qu'elle travaille là-dessus.